Sorry to keep you waiting, complicated business.
My name is Heather Swain. Philadelphia has always been my home. Life was good until it happened. I'm friends with a cybernetic enhanced human-like frog created to save Earth. Nobody appreciated or understood him, but I did. We were good friends who enjoyed hanging out with a bucket from the chicken fry. Just me, Cyber Frog, and his very large brother, Salamandroid. Until the invasion hit. They rained from the sky. These space invader giant hornets attacked everyone, killing more than could stay alive, and covered the earth with giant blood honey hives. They can't fly near trees, so we hid in the woods, burning endless fires to keep them away, wearing red so they can't see and kill us all. The last time I saw a Cyber Frog, he told me he'd track me down, but it's been decades. And there's been no sign of him. Yet, I can't shake the feeling he is not gone. I believe he will return again. We need Cyber Frog and his brother Salamandroid to return and fight off these invaders. To take back our wrecked planet, so we can live without fear. If you see my friend Cyber Frog, tell him I need him. We need him to save the world. versus Cyber Frog Wrecked Planet. Join the fight.
Yeah, be undeniable, everybody. Welcome to Comic Artist Pro Secrets. It's me, Ethan Van Sciver, your friend and host, 29-year veteran of the comic book industry, world's most charming, disarming, elegant, eloquent, and yet humble man. Great big Sopranos fan, trusted member of the media. What a great show we've got for you today. This is kind of an honor and a thrill for me. I've heard about this guy for a long time. His legend precedes him. Listen, I'm a humble man. Part of my intro is to let you guys know that I am devoid of ego. And all of you know that. All of you recognize in me profound godly humility. I am not somebody who believes I am entitled to walk among the greats. And yet, somehow I am privileged. I don't know what it is. I don't know what gives me this privilege. You can speculate. It does seem to happen that I get to meet some really great people. And converse with them. I'm going to introduce this guy to you in a minute. First, let me just say hi to the chat. We've got to do that, first of all. Uncle E needs a top hat, says Anonymity T2. I have a few. You guys have seen me wearing various top hats. When they're appropriate, I do wear those top hats. Let's see. Uncle E, Hail EVS, Hail the Chat, says Ryan Johnson. Ryan Johnson, God's peace be with you, says Old Dirty Fatty. What a weird thing to say at the beginning of this stream. 7 of 9 says, hi, Comics Gate. Looking sharp, B, says Lethal Diva. Thank you, except for this. Look at this. It's one little strand of beard hair. Let me push that. I can't get that to... I've been working so hard. You know, grooming comes in second, you know, when you're working the way that I have been. All right, guys. Since none of you are saying anything interesting at all, this is typical, very typical of you guys. Let me down when I need you the most. Let me introduce you to... All right, there we go. Let me introduce... I was about to introduce you and I look down and you're gone. I'm like...
I was like, let's take this off mute for a second, and then blip.
Yeah, you were gone. Yeah.
Yeah, hit the wrong button.
Okay, well, I'm glad you're back. Ladies and gentlemen, Larry Correa. Am I pronouncing that correctly?
Yeah, Korea, just like the country.
Korea. Yeah, that's how I heard it, and I was like, okay, I think I got that right, because very nice to meet you, my friend, my new friend. How are you?
Yeah, I'm excited. I'm excited to be on, and I've learned a lot about you guys in the last couple of days and what you've done, and I think it's awesome. So I'm really happy to be here.
You are an author, a famous sci-fi author. Your credits, people talk about you with reverence and respect, especially in our community and communities that are sort of, similar to ours. We all kind of walk in the same circles. I mean, the difference between you and me, essentially, and the people in Comicsgate are that our books have pictures. But when it comes to everything else, we are similar in that we love science fiction. And you are a sci-fi author. Are you a member of SIFWA? I dare ask you. SFWA?
Oh, no. I'm the anti-SIFWA. I'm the guy that writes all the articles about why authors should save their $80 and never join that place.
So SIFWA is the Science Fiction Writers Association. They would essentially, in my opinion, syphilis seems to be a den of scum and villainy and iniquity. I think it's horrible. You know, in the scriptures, they would call that iniquity. They seem to be where the SJWs hang out and dominate and control science fiction writers.
Oh, yeah. In the old days, it was actually a kind of a normal trade organization, did a lot of stuff to help writers out. But like everything else, you know, the left infiltrates it, kills it, wears it as a skin suit. It's horrible. And I could tell you so many stories about that place. It's
what does it mean to kill it and wear it as a skin suit?
Well, I think it's the David Burge quote. That's how the left operates. They find an institution, invade it, take it over, kill it, and then wear it as a skin suit while demanding respect. And that's SIFWA. I mean, that's pretty much to a T how they work. They've run out all the conservatives and libertarians, though, so now they're just eating each other. It's kind of awesome to watch.
Wait, hold on a second. We got a ceremony here. Jay Bomafan says, say hi to Comicsgate, Larry. Now, you just have to say, hi, Comicsgate.
Hi, Comicsgate.
Simple as that. There are some people who are, Larry, there are some people who are actually afraid to do that. We had a Marvel writer come on, called me at like 1 a.m, and he wanted to just negotiate terms. There are a lot of moments where in the comic book industry, they want to negotiate terms with us. And this guy came on, and I just said, before we talk, now's not a great time. You know, you're live, you're in front of 2,000 people, I told him, but before we speak, why don't you just say hi to the audience? It's Comicsgate. 2,000 Comicsgaters are watching you. They're comic book fans, customers. Say hi, Comicsgate. And he was like, because he knew that the very act, I mean, this is how the comic book industry is. And I'm sure that you will understand this. But the comic book industry sees us as toxic. We are poisonous. Oh,
yeah. Barbarian outsiders.
Yes.
Horrible, horrible monsters who are the worst thing that's ever happened to the history of art.
God, I hope that's true. I hope that's how they see us. But they, just the act of saying hello to us would have meant that he would have paid a price from his friends, his peers.
Oh, yeah. Don't worry. For me, everybody in my industry who could already blackball me has already blackballed me. I mean, I'm hated by all the right people. Mm-hmm. So I don't care. I'm fine. What are they going to do? Edit my Wikipedia more?
Oh, my gosh. Dude, my Wikipedia. It's like, why did they do this?
Like, they have no lives. It's a hobby.
Death Metal Hero says, Larry's Monster Hunter International are a hell of a fun read. Go get them. Welcome to the fun, Larry.
And then, cool. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, some people here already know who you are, and those who don't are going to get to know you. Yeah, this Marvel guy, he called up. People are asking that I play the clip. All right, I want you to see the phenomenon that is a Marvel, the biggest Marvel writer. His name is Donnie Cates, calling us at 1 a.m. while me and other comic book artists are live streaming and trying to have a conversation with us, and just the utter terror. I mean, I'm a nice guy. I'm not somebody who's going to hurt anybody. I'm really not. But to see the terror, like this guy has all kinds of power, shouldn't have been afraid to talk to us at all. And yet he was. Here's a little 2-minute video that should bring you some glee. Hey, Donnie Cates.
Ethan, how you doing, pal?
Good. I'm live right now. Like, people can hear you. So I'm warning you of that right now. Like, I'm actually doing a live stream right now. You want to say hi to Comicsgate?
Well, I would prefer if you and I could have a private conversation. I really would.
Well, I can't because I'm having a very public conversation. But if you want to say, hi, Comicsgate, they could hear you right now. And they'd be very happy. 2,000 people.
I understand that. But I understand that, Tiberius. I get it. We're all good. Everything is good here. I'm just saying that a text, hey, look, I'll just say this. Hey, you know what? And I'll just say this. All right. And then what I will say publicly here, I And
right.
I'm serious when I say that. I can see where you're coming from. Okay. I don't know. That's the conversation, right? And look, you're not gonna get this from fucking Scott Snyder. You're not gonna get this from anybody else. Like, I'm actually trying to fucking, like, reach out to you, right? And if I'm not being as eloquent as I want to be right now, I'd like to leave you with this, and but I will say this, man, I will never do anything to try and take food off of anyone's tables.
All right, pal. All right, you have a good one. See you later. Woo!
What that on was earth? Amazing.
What makes these people?
Man, I have never been that scared of anything in my life.
Think about that. Now, this is somebody. Now, first of all, I mean, some people are scared. Like, you know, conservatives and Republicans working in entertainment industries need to be scared. You know, it's like we do. If you want to continue to work for these big corporations, you need to be careful what you say. But even the people who, I mean, that guy's like a transvestite. Like, he should not be scared at all of anything that he's it, like. He's writing the biggest book. He is completely soy based. What the hell are you afraid of? Like, you should just march in here and say what you want to say to me, and that should be it. What am I going to do about it? I'm just Comicsgate. So,
you know who that sounds like is when a teenager gets pulled over by a cop and they got a beer in the car. Yes. Is there anything in the car you need to tell me about, son?
It was fun.
Like, I mean, crap,
what is it? Why are they? Why do they do this? Why do they create this environment where they're so terrified of each other? I mean, of themselves.
My take is it's kind of like they get addicted to the outrage. That's how they get power and social clout, and it's just kind of like this constant game of one-upmanship. It is religious. It's a religion to them, right? And yeah. So they got their commandments and they got their heretics, and they get like points and they can move up the ladder by how victimized they are. And it's kind of hilarious to watch now that they've like gotten rid of all of us, all us outsiders, you know, us non-believers, us infidels have been kicked out. They're terrified. They can't cross the line. Like I know really good, like solid, science fiction and fantasy writers that are liberals that love my stuff. They love my work. Mm-hmm. They can't say that. They cannot say that in public ever. They would get skinned and eaten. Like, they would just get decapitated. I know one dude who picked up my epic fantasy series because he wanted to do a review of it, and because he figured it would suck because I was a right winger. You know, he's like, I'm going to review this book and talk about what a piece of crap Larry Correa is, right? So he picks up Son of the Black Sword. He reads it. In private, I hear later that he thought it was the best fantasy novel he read in a decade. So he never posted his review. He couldn't say a word because they would murder him if he praised somebody with the wrong something politics. Else.
Yeah, I get messages from these SJWs who work in comics who just go, hey, like, just between you and me, I really admire what you're doing, but don't tell anybody I said so. And I'm just like, you're all afraid of each other. How can see, this is a male dominated hobby, I would think, comic books. I don't know if sci-fi novels are so much. Maybe they are. The women probably read them in a much greater number than comics, I would think. But
it's pretty well split. I think it depends on what genre sci-fi you're in and what genre fantasy. The more fantastical and romantic, the more likely to be female. The more like military sci-fi action adventure, more guys. I'm about 70-30 my readership. 60-40 maybe male female.
So let me ask you, when did you, first of all, how did you get into writing sci-fi? Let me ask you the most boring and general question of all, and then we're going to get into the juicy stuff. But how did you get into writing sci-fi novels? What's your origin story?
Ironically, I owned a machine gun store. For reals. Yeah, I was a firearms instructor and huge gun nut. And I always loved to read, always loved to write, huge reader. First time I tried to write a book was actually in college, and it was terrible. But then I was working in the gun business, and I was talking to some other gun nuts one time. And we just made these jokes about lines I'd like to hear in a horror movie someday. And, like, the idea was horror movies if they starred us gun people, right?
Yeah.
And so as a joke, I just kind of ran with that, and I started writing stories, which would turn into Monster Hunter International, which is my first novel. And it's just like a bunch of gun nuts and military contractors fighting monsters for a living. And I self-published it on an internet gun forum. Hmm. And it blew up huge. And this is back in 2007. So back at
you haven't been doing this very long. 2007 was your start.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, so 2007 was my first self-published book. 2009 was my first professionally trade-published book with Bain Books. I've been there ever since. I've written 25 novels now. Wow. So about two a year, give
two
or take.
Two a year, is there? Yeah. When did you start to notice, when did you start to get a little bit of pushback, or when did you start to notice suss out, you know, the element in the industry?
Yeah, well, so I didn't come into this from like a fan background, so I didn't really know the ins and outs of like the politics and whatnot. What happened was I actually got nominated for a prestigious award. It was called the Campbell. It was for Best New Writer. And so I got nominated for this. And as soon as I got nominated for the award, I knew I wasn't going to win because I looked on the internet to see what people were saying. And already it was like, ew, he owns a gun store. Disgusting. Ooh, right wing. Yuck. Murder children. And just going on and on and on. I was like, wow, I'm coming in last because these are the voters. Right. But then I went to Worldcon, which was the convention that they give this award at. And oh my gosh, it was nuts. It was the most lopsided left-wing circle jerk you could imagine. Just a bunch of high school mean girls giving each other props and then screwing everybody else. Back in those days, it was like if you were an Obama voter or a Romney voter, you know. It was crazy how biased it was. And I heard all these people complaining about it and whining about it, but no one was doing anything about it. No one would talk about it in public. I met all these other conservative and libertarian and Republican writers, but none of them would ever talk about this in public because they would know they would get yelled at. I mean, there was some, like my publisher, Bayon, they didn't care. And there was a couple guys there like John Ringo. John Ringo was a culture warrior going way back. You know, John would just say whatever he wanted and you know, damn the consequences. But then, so I got involved in this and I started looking at it. It's like, you know, this is crap. And I started, and I'm a former accountant too. That's what I got my degree in. And I started looking at the stats of who all was voting for this and how many people were voting for this most prestigious award. And I was like, this is crap. I got tons of fans. How come I just, why don't I just go get my wrong fans, my Republican fans? And why don't I just get them involved into this Worldcon circle jerk? And I did. And so a couple years later, I came back with a bunch more books and I was really popular as a New York Times bestseller, you know, at the time. I can't make that list anymore. I'll never make it again.
Why?
Their
will we get to that in the story? I mean, is there something that happened, like a change that happened?
No, it's the New York Times bestseller list is rigged. It's straight up rigged.
Yeah.
Like, oh yeah. So what it is on that, I'm getting off the story here, but what I used to make the New York Times bestseller list all the time. Like every time a new book would come out, I would sell enough copies to get on there. And then once I became well known as, you know, with having the wrong politics, never again, I was out. Yeah. And didn't matter how much I sold. And I've had a couple books come out that were like huge, like they like great, awesome release weeks, nothing. Whereas like, I'm looking at like the actual stats and I'm beating 75% of the New York Times bestseller list that week. I don't make it, but, it's just, you know, it's one of those things. But so I went back and a couple years later, it's about 2013. I got together a bunch of my friends who were not the kind of people, you know, there are kind of people. Mm-hmm. And I got them involved. All I had to do was buy memberships to this prestigious organization. And they did. And they got me a nomination. And that was like the end of the friggin' world. And then the next year we came back bigger and got more people involved and we got a
bunch of. Now, what do you mean getting them involved? Now, did they have just regular people how to vote?
Yeah. So the way this works is Worldcon has memberships. And so if you're a member of Worldcon, you can attend the convention and you can also vote for the Hugo Awards, which was the big fancy awards.
Can you buy a membership? I don't have to be anyone special. I could just buy an award.
Well, it used to be. I think they changed this now to stop people like us. Mm-hmm. But it's like $40. And so I did this big silly thing. And like the first one I did, I used the Sarah McLachlan song with the sad puppies, where they have the puppies in the pound. And for like $1, you can prevent animal cruelty and it's in the arms of an angel, you know?
Yeah.
So we made a music video and we made cartoons. I'm a terrible cartoonist, by the way. You're an amazing artist. I'm a terrible artist.
Oh, thanks.
But I drew terrible cartoons saying, if you want to prevent puppy-related sadness, you can vote for your favorite authors to get awards. And I got a bunch of people involved and they registered and got a bunch of people with the wrong politics nominated. And these people lost their mind. So the second year we did this. And what happened is the next thing I know, I wake up the next morning and we're in 16 national newspapers and publications about this right-wing, sexist, racist, homophobic, misogynistic hate monger. That have come to kick women and minorities out of publishing.
Why does it go there? Why does it have to be? Why does our existence? I remember the bumper stickers that said coexist. Why can't we coexist? Why is it like that my being there or your being there means that women and minorities can be there? I don't understand.
Well, the ironic thing was, and here's the crazy part. We looked at, because the year before I had did this, the winners had been 16 white liberals and one Asian liberal, and they declared it a huge win for diversity, right? Hmm. And so my nominees that we got were actually all over the board because we didn't care. We were just like, hey, you're the kind of person that would normally get ignored by these jerks. Let's get you in here. Hmm. And so we had every race, creed, color, nationality, sexual orientation. I didn't know. In fact, I had people was like, people are like, oh, I'm bisexual. I'm gay. I'm like, really?
Oh, yeah, cool. Yeah. But there's we've got them in the chat. I mean, I call my chat gay all the time, but I mean, most of them are literal homosexuals. Many of them are and people of color and women, of course. I mean, we are naturally diverse. There's no, we don't, award people for
it. Well, the funny thing is, I got a bunch of the places because I lawyered up and started threatening libel lawsuits against a bunch of the magazines, the one that were more egregious, who hadn't phrased it correctly to hide. And they had to print retractions, and the retractions are like, so they'd have the big headline about the sexist racist, and then they'd have the correction, except for, and then we list off 14 of our nominees that were some minority group, including me. I'm mixed race. My dad's browner than Barack Obama.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, see?
My mom is super white, which is funny because she's actually from North Africa, but she's the white one. but the funny thing is,
you're literally an African American. That's amazing.
Portuguese. We're a little bit of everything.
Okay. All right. We're suspicious of Portuguese people because of Anna, that Star Wars girl. But, we'll overlook.
We're very shifty.
I thought so. I thought so with Anna. Okay. Let me take 1 minute here just to show people in the chat. We're going to continue this discussion. But before we do, I want to let you know that if you just drop down the description, you're going to see a link to purchase one of, this is your newest book, right?
Oh yeah, this is my latest one. I wrote it with a fellow named Steve Diamond. It's a dark fantasy. So think World War I, trench warfare, in like evil fairy tale world. It's awesome. Big fighting robots, kind of like a tank crew. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, go pick up a copy of this. The link is in the description. You can get it on Kindle. You can get the audio CD. You can get the hardcover pick it up and give it a read. And Larry's written 25 books, so they're all probably going to be here on Amazon. You can you can check those out as well. Okay.
The other guy wrote this particular one with Steve Diamond. He's a fan of yours. And I didn't know that. And so I texted him this morning. I was like, yeah. So I'm going on, Ethan's show. And Steve's like, really? And he's like, holy crap, that's awesome. He's like, tell him I love his stuff.
He's Steve. That's cool.
That's amazing. He's like, I back Cyberfrog.
Yes. I hope he's not mad at me. Cyberfrog's a year and 1 month late right now. Cyberfrog 2. I just finished it on Sunday. So
nice.
We'll be getting that out to print soon. But okay, so anyway, this is great. So now you've basically infiltrated the Hugo Awards. And by the way, a lot of the weirdos who started attacking me early on in back channels were talking about this. This is amazing. They were saying, we can't let the sad puppies happen again. They actually anticipated Comicsgate, and they were saying, we can't let the sad puppies happen again. I said, what the fuck are you talking? Like, I had no idea what they were talking about. What do you mean sad puppies? So it's interesting. You are the creator of the sad puppies.
Yeah, so we were kind of like a proto battle of the culture war is what it was. We were like one of the early skirmishes in the culture war. And like then Gamergate came along after us and Comicsgate. And so it was like we went books, video games, comics, and now it's spread into every aspect of society. The stuff that I was talking about years ago, people thought I was nuts. You know, I was telling people like there's all these industries that are biased and broken and they don't care about profit. They just care about woke. And people didn't believe me. I was talking about social justice work. In fact, like George R. R. Martin, me and him had a big famous public debate over this. And he thought that I had made up the word social justice warrior. He thought I had invented that term. That's how out of touch everybody is. And so this is all stuff we're talking about years ago. But fast forward to today, I mean, there's nobody in America who doesn't know we're in a culture war. And it's like every industry, every school, every office, every corporation. I mean, it's invaded every aspect of life now. So we're just guys like us, we're just on the leading edge.
I mean, I don't think I'm on the leading edge at all. I think after Gamergate, when I was being canceled by social justice warriors and I was seeing all of these, they were very peculiar. It seemed very organized and I didn't understand what was going on, why this was, I was very much a normal person who just said, maybe if I just apologize for all of these things that they're saying about me, I'm sorry that my signature is shaped like a diamond and that resembles a swastika. It wasn't intentional. Didn't mean to hurt anyone's feelings. You know, all of this stuff. And I didn't understand what was going on. And, you know, of course, apologizing or acknowledging that maybe I was at fault in any way only made it worse, which seemed counterhuman to me. And I was talking to the EIC of DC Comics on my very last day of working there. You know, they had let me know. They just said, look, you know, like they're making too much trouble. There's too much noise. We're trying to merge with AT&T right now. You know, we're bringing over Brian Michael Bendis, another writer, to sort of make us look better. And then they're calling you a white supremacist and putting these articles out, you know, saying that, you know, you are a Nazi. And it's too much bad publicity right now. So we got to let you go. I'm talking to Dan DiDio, EIC of DC. And I said, you're not going to believe this, but there's this organized, weird thing, this cult in the comic book industry of politically motivated radical leftists who seek to destroy conservatives. I know that sounds crazy, but it's true, you know? And he went, he said something like, you wouldn't believe what I know. He's like, or something like that. Like he knew about this. You know, now obviously, but you know, just looking back at 2017, 2018, when this was happening and my sort of complete naivete to this whole thing and what was going on. If only I had paid attention to what was going on with the sad puppies, you know, way back, 2013, that would have been I probably would have been informed a little bit more about all this.
Don't feel bad, man. It snuck up on a lot of people. And it's so pervasive. And it's funny because I would warn. So it seemed like most of the conservatives knew about this kind of stuff, but they didn't know how bad it was. Some did, some didn't. I could tell you some stories that would blow your mind about authors have been screwed. And it wasn't really until this became more overt that everyone kind of caught on. And then we started talking to each other and really started sharing our stories. And all of a sudden it's like, holy crap, our industry is riddled with cancer. And it's funny because during this, I had a lot of liberal friends. I mean, liberal because my industry, there's so many liberals and they're decent. There's like a lot of them are decent people. And I was warning them like, you know, once they eat us, they're going to come for you. You're going to cross one of their lines and they're going to come get you. And they're like, oh no, that's only for you horrible Trump voter, awful bad people, right? And it's like, no, trust me. And the other day, like Sifwa threw out one of their grand masters because she said, instead of saying people of color, she said colored people.
Oh, yeah.
She's 72 years old and she's an old hippie. And she's a nice lady, but she said, She said that, and then, oh my gosh, they ripped her to pieces, kicked her out instantly, threw her husband out too, who wasn't even there.
Without just hesitation.
Without hesitation.
We covered that. What was her name? What was this woman's name?
Mercedes Lackey.
Mercedes Lackey. So, yeah, she's sitting there. She's being an SJW. She's a leftist, but she's in her 70s. So the thing about words and leftists is that, you know, some words that they invent fall out of fashion and you're no longer allowed to say them because they become racist or hurtful or whatever it is. SJW is one of those terms. They invented that. We wouldn't be calling them social justice warriors or SJWs. They chose to be called that. And what basically happened in that situation is that it became a label that identified their horrible behavior. So as such, they no longer want to be called that. We got to move on and change terms, and et cetera, et cetera. But yeah, like Black people have been called various things progressively, you know, nicer and nicer, I think, over the years, thank goodness. But at one point, you know, in the 1960s and 70s, I think, they were called colored people. Well, that was what you called them. That was just, you know,
that she was talking about was there, and he's her age, and he didn't care. He wasn't offended.
Of course not. So this poor woman gets up there and she's trying to tribute this horrific, by the way, person of color, his writing and the things that he writes about.
It is, and the stuff that he supported. So I'm not going to talk about that dude, but man, that's a train wreck right there.
Whole other situation. But
yeah, and it's got nothing to do. This has nothing to do with race.
No,
this has everything to do with some other topics that would probably get you demonetized if you talked about them on your channel.
Yeah, that's the creepy stuff these people slip in their books. Yeah. I was thinking about Stephen King's It the other day. I read that when I was like 12 years old, and I was like, am I really reading a sex scene about children? Am I reading a gangbang scene about little kids in the sewer right now?
Oh, yeah. Stephen King does not like me, by the way.
Really?
Yeah, I'm on his poopy list.
What for? What happened?
Oh, years ago. Gun control. Gun control. He blocked me on Twitter for talking about gun control. Also, I also had the how dare I question his writing ability, because the dude can't write an ending to save his life. His endings suck.
Yeah. What a disappointment.
His finale is like flip a coin if it's going to be good or not. That dude struggles with finales. Mm-hmm. I've talked about that on my writing podcast a few times. But no, gun control was what that was, because the dude does not have a flipping clue about gun laws.
I lost a lot of friends, usually from other countries, a lot of artists. One of my favorite artists was a guy named Brian Boland, and he is fantastic. He's a British gentleman, and we were getting along really well. He knew I was a conservative, but he's British, and I'm American. I'm, you know, very, you know, pro-Second Amendment, and I would post about it. I would put it on my Facebook, and he said, I can no longer, I find your views about guns repugnant. I can't relate to that. I really don't understand I don't understand the conflict there. I don't understand what the debate is about a person's right to defend themselves. I don't get that. We can argue about various things that are, you know, that just seem to come down to a matter of opinion, but you have the right to own a gun. If we lived in a world where guns didn't exist and there were only sticks on the ground and one guy had a stick and he wanted to hit you with it, you'd have a moral right to have the same stick to hit him back or defend yourself. People now have, bad guys have guns. You have every right to own the same weapons to defend your family. This to me is a no-brainer.
That's what got me in trouble when I first started as a writer was a lot of conservatives come out and they got to keep their, they kind of keep their opinions to themselves, or they keep their heads down and don't rock the boat and piss off their editors. I owned a gun store, when I broke out. And so like, I never had a chance to hide. It's like, so immediately right out the gate, it's like, ew, it's the gun guy.
I don't want to hide that. It just seems like common sense to me. I don't want to hide. Like there's, you know, there's some points of view that it's like, well, you know, we really going to talk about abortion? Well, I am. I'm going to talk about abortion a little bit, especially now. But
I did a I got unfriended a lot over the last month.
Yes. I love it. You find out who your real friends are. But when it comes to guns, like, I'm sorry, I have absolutely there. You know, to me, you know, it's more freedom. And I you know, these arguments, they should all come down to embracing freedom. And the Second Amendment is all about personal freedom. So, I can't abide. I can't really argue and take a counter argument seriously. None of them really make sense. The arguments happened. It's been won over and over and over again.
Super illogical. I don't know how many people got yelled at by the last couple of weeks who have a Ukrainian flag in their name. And they're telling me, I don't understand why civilians would need an assault rifle.
Are you kidding me? I mean,
it's like you literally have a Ukrainian flag in your name. And I don't understand why. I mean, like, they were handing out AK-47s like candy, grandmas. imagine if Putin invaded Texas, okay, where everybody's got an AR, okay?
Yeah, it wouldn't happen so easily.
Idaho would be way worse than the Ukraine, okay? Idaho, you're getting smoked.
Idaho, yeah. All right, hail Idaho. Yeah, like that whole thing. And then the other thing about the Ukraine situation is they stopped calling us Nazis. I don't know if you've noticed that. We're terrorists now. Mm-hmm. They stopped calling us Nazis or insurrectionists. And the reason for that is because they're literally supporting Nazis now. I mean, you know, over in the Ukraine, you know, it's like there are actual Nazis over there that you guys have pledged yourselves to. Concerned about.
Politics are strange bedfellows, and the weird thing is American liberals seem to think that, like, their weird pedestrian sheltered version of geopolitical reality is, like, true. And it's like most of the world ain't America, you know, and America's actually a really nice country. Yeah. And America's actually a remarkably unracist country, all things considered, with our history and all the stuff we've gone through. The rest of the world's got some flipping issues, man.
Yeah, it is true.
And they just assume that all the crap they say about us, it applies. Isaac, no, it's a different world out there. And you guys just are not even processing it. But oh well, they're going to call us whatever the fashionable thing is. I'm cool with insurrectionist. That sounds kind of, it's new, it's fresh, it's kind of different. Mix it up a little bit.
The insurrectionist. It's fascinating. Yeah. I like that. I like traitor. All of these things.
We're the world's most well-armed demographic, and we threw an insurrection and didn't bring a single firearm.
I know, just flags. I watched the videos from that, and they were just touring the people's. It's the people's house. It's the people's property. They seem. I mean, there are a few guys who went too far. There are a few guys who went into Nancy Pelosi's office, picked up her phone, and demanded that Trump be reinstated. Those are some very naughty boys, and they should probably be punished a little bit.
There were some people who did some violent stuff and broke windows and punched people. And I mean, it was like any other big protest, but I mean, they've got people who did nothing but basically trespass, and they're still holding them in jail a year and a half later for trespassing.
It's ridiculous. You know,
they're trying to throw the book at these guys. I'll plug a friend's documentary. And Nick Searcy did a documentary about January 6th. It's really good. He was there, and he got a lot of footage and a lot of interviews with people, but it's very, very different than what the news media portrays it as.
Yeah. Oh, I'd like to say Nick Searcy, great guy on Twitter. I love his
stud. He's a good dude.
Yeah. I haven't gotten to talk to him yet. I hope to. All right. So let's just get back to this here. So basically the sad puppies. Now, from what I understand, you guys were not allowed to nominate yourselves anymore. These people weren't allowed to nominate you anymore. So what happened there?
It got really weird. Because what happened is we did it for 3 years and they changed the rules halfway through. And I actually don't even know what the new rules are. But they did it to basically, like, you had to be a member for such amount of time, or basically they did it to stop us from, like, bringing in a bunch of new people ever again. But I actually don't know the specific, because at that point I was so sick of these scumbags, and my main goal was to expose them. I just wanted to, like, you know, rip the Band-Aid off and let the world see what a bunch of crap, you know, this was. So for me, it was mission accomplished, and I bailed out. There was some other writers stuck around and tried to keep it going, like Brad Torgerson, and Sarah Hoyt, and they tried to keep it, which was really ironic there because Sarah was, you know, female and an immigrant woman. And we would do these interviews with all these different newspapers, and they were like New York Times, Boston Globe, and they'd interview us, and they'd interview me, or they'd interview Brad, and they're talking about how we're misogynistic sexists, and we're like, well, what about Sarah? Why don't you go interview Sarah? She's helping run this too. Not a single reporter ever contacted Sarah, not one. You know, that just shows how they are. But no, so they changed the rules. I bailed out. I don't know. And they just kind of have just gone to crap afterwards. Their current Worldcon is going to be held in Chengdu, China.
Wow.
So communist China. So after all this time of these guys talking about like, oh, we have to protect liberal values, now they're going to China that has concentration camps and COVID lockdowns where they're starving cities.
How are they going to afford? How are these authors going to afford to go to China to
be able
to attend this con? What's going to happen there?
I actually hope they throw most of these people in prison camps. there's a couple of them the secret police will probably hire because they'd be fantastic at it. There's a couple that, like, honestly, there's the former president of CIFWA. There's this woman. The nicest thing I can say about her is she would have been a stupendous Stasi agent. So I'm sure some of them will actually probably stay in China and fit in great. But no, actually, I kind of hope that the Chinese, because the Chinese just manufactured however many voters they needed to get it. And I'm sure that China hopefully will keep it forever and it'll just die there. That'd be awesome. I would just laugh. Well, it's funny because after I left, it just got more and more and more and more. Because I used to say what my original premise was is that if you had the wrong politics, they were going to screw you. They were just there to give their friends, like-minded people. As one publishing house kind of dominated everything. They're super liberal. And I said that, if you're an outsider, you're screwed. Which is funny because then after we left, they went like 10,000% overboard and did exactly what I said, to the point it was like so blatantly obvious, where it's just the same cadre of people just giving each other awards. Mm-hmm. And what made it even better was they started eating each other. And so like at one point, George Martin was the announcer and he read some names wrong. So they declared he was racist and canceled him, and then gave an award the next year to a speech about how he was a bad racist person.
Jeez. I mean, that's something else. I mean, what kills me about this is just, I mean, okay. Like this is obviously more serious than we really thought about. I thought I'd given my life over to a very frivolous hobby industry. I really thought this will be fun. I'm going to be a comic book artist. Something happened along the way where these leftists, these poisonous, these communists, essentially decided that politics were in fact downstream from culture, and therefore they need to dominate and control every aspect, every hobby, everything that's important in popular culture, subvert it, control it. You're right. Skin it, wear it as a skin suit, and dance around and demand respect. And it hit me like a ton of bricks. I really, it took me a long time. And part of this channel to me, and part of what ComicsGate represents, is like an ongoing attempt to understand this. We witness it. We see it happening in culture all the time. And I want to know what's going on. I want to know who's behind this. I have so many questions. We just discovered this year, I was talking to Dana Loush. I was on her show. And I just kind of said, off the top of my head, I don't even know why I said this, inspired by the Lord, I said, I think there's some form of government incentivizing this behavior. Why would this be happening? Why would all of these companies, why would all these big corporations, Frito-Lay, Gillette, Disney, why are they all going woke like this against their own self-interest? Because they are turning off, surely they're turning off 50% of the country. It's better to just say nothing. So why are they taking these very strange, aggressive, radical stances in their advertising and what they're putting out, when Get Woke, Go Broke ostensibly is true? I mean, people back away, the stock drops. What's going on? And I think there's some kind of government agency incentivizing this. There must be. And she said, wow, you think so? And I was just like, I think so. And everybody mocked me. I got everybody on Twitter calling me crazy. And then we uncovered ESG. And now that's what everyone is talking about right now. I was one of the first people in ComicsGate, I don't know, a few other little cultural groups like ours, to really try to understand and explain what ESG is and why it's the answer to all of this, why this is happening. We have BlackRock, we have this enormous hedge fund, a series of hedge funds worth close to like $36 trillion that are making it possible, thanks to Obama's Secretary of Labor and some new laws that were instituted under his reign, to incentivize big corporations via investment dollars to go woke, to promote leftist values, environmental, social, governance. And if they can do that, they become entitled to or eligible for investment based solely on those factors. This is shocking, and it explains absolutely everything. Why this phrase, like diversity, equity, inclusion, like why do they all repeat that like a mantra? Because it's built into the social aspect of ESG. We need to see,
like, mandatory for NASDAQ, I believe. Mm-hmm. And then they were selling, NASDAQ was selling training on how to pass your how to raise your ESG numbers. So it was like a racket. And so they're circling back. I don't know if you saw the thing the other day with Elon Musk with Tesla showing their lousy ESG scores. Yeah. Because he got out of line. He's upset the narrative, and he's currently the nail that has to get hammered down. You know, they always all that, whatever the nail is that sticks up, they got to hammer down. And yeah, so this ESG thing, and I think that is a giant part of it. And I think it's a cultural imperative for the left, because they don't make their own children anymore. They have to, like, you know, so it's not like they can raise up people to believe the way they believe. They have to, like, get you through every other thing. They got the idea that entertainment industry was a tool of propaganda and something that could be used to sway public thought long, long, long before the right. Our side just never took it serious. Guys like us were just like, oh, you know, hey, well, you're just doing nerdy stuff. It's like, yeah, but you know what? Culture is downstream of this nerdy stuff. And you can either read books about heroes with, you know, values and courage and, you know, morals and whatnot, or you can read, you know, weird, crappy, nihilistic, garbage, socialist, dying polar bear fiction, you know, and everything's global warming and the bad guy's Donald Trump. And it's just the same old crap. But they got that before we did. They have a head start on us because of that. And boy, they have got some industries like locked up. Like publishing is like 99% blue. I mean, my publisher is an anomaly. She is a freakish anomaly in this business, and that she just doesn't care. She's all like, you know, Tony Weisskopf, she's awesome. And Tony is, do you tell a good story that entertains people and makes them happy? I don't give a crap if you're a communist or to the right of Genghis Khan. You're cool. I'll take you. But everywhere else, man, it is all about you are on message or you are gone, or you make so much money for them that they can't afford to get rid of you. There are a couple guys that get away with; they're just too successful to get tossed out.
Yeah,
I don't know. We're playing catch up.
Well, we certainly are. I mean, we're way behind. We got snookered big time. I want to talk about a series of tweets that you put out, which were pretty peaking. I like this. By the way, you can follow Larry Correa on Twitter at MonsterHunter45. You want to go over there? Also, of course, Servants of War. This is his new book on Amazon right now. You can pick up a copy of this in several different formats. I recommend that you do that. The link is in the description below, or just look up Larry Correa like I did right on Amazon. You'll find all of his books. But this is his newest. So if you want to throw Larry some support and read a great sci-fi novel, this is a great way to do it. So this is interesting. Right-wing punditry. If only there were conservative creatives. Hello, right-wing punditry. Too bad we've lost the culture war. Here is my 5,000th video about why this woke megacorporation sucks. I hope my 800,000 subscribers give me those sweet hate clicks. Oh, Larry, I jumped off of that train. I was on that train for a little while right here on this channel.
No, I get it. It's easy. I'm with you. I like to hate on Disney too. Mm-hmm. You know, and every time they regurgitate some crap or Marvel or DC does something just stupid or Netflix does something ridiculous, it's easy to bag on them. And we're right too. But I think at the same time, I think we need to offer people alternatives. I mean, there's a lot of dissatisfied people out there, but they're not going to stop consuming entertainment. They'll consume something, and they'll keep consuming the same old crap if they don't know if there's an alternative to turn towards.
Yeah, I just we're so far behind. I mean, you know, right now the seeds that like Stan Lee and Walt Disney planted 50, 80 years ago have come to fruition, and finally, you know, these trees can sort of be exploited. These beautiful things that they made can be exploited and destroyed by social justice warriors, because both of those guys are no longer around to protect them. But we have to actually, we can't come up with Spider-Man or Mickey Mouse right away. It takes time, and we need conservative creative types to actually begin to build things. We need more guys like Orson Scott Card out there, who, by the way, do you know Orson Scott Card? You must.
I've met him. I don't know. We're not friends or anything, but we've met a couple times.
Really? Why aren't the three of us best friends? we're all Mormons. I mean, come on.
Yeah, I've met him at LTUE in Provo, Utah, and he's a nice guy. And it's actually, I did a thing with him once where we were talking about this very topic. And because he had been around so much longer than the rest of us. And somebody asked him a question. Orson Scott Card, or you know, Scott Carter, are you still despised by the left? And he's like, I don't know who their God is, but I'm pretty sure I'm still their devil.
That's a great line.
It was a great line.
Orson Scott Card was one of the first guys when I was working for DC Comics, probably around 2010. And I was still like, I'm working in this industry and I'm surrounded by kind of effeminate men and weird kind of pushy women, but I'm okay. I can do this. Orson Scott Card was the first case of cancel culture that I can recall that I actually took note of, because there was going to be a Superman book. It was going to be some kind of collected edition of Superman stories. And Orson Scott Card had written this Superman story. It was only 8 or 10 pages. And it was important that DC publish it. They wanted to publish it because his movie, a movie based on one of his books, was going to come out starring Harrison Ford. He was hot, you know, hotter than ever. So they wanted to publish this story. It was as though DC Comics was going to publish an illustrated version of Mein Kampf. The reaction that these leftists, you know, I thought they were just liberals, but the reaction the fact that DC Comics might publish Orson Scott Card, 8-10 pages of his work, garnered, was over the top hysteria. You can't do this. It doesn't support gay marriage. Look at these statements that he's made about gay marriage. You know, you can't do this. This man is a Nazi. That's when I really started to hear Nazi more frequently. And I cannot recall. I remember DC stood up for a long time. Now, I don't remember if they actually did publish him or not, if they withstood this attempt to destroy him. But boy, I really said, this is hysteria. This is insanity. Like, even if he were all of these things, clearly he is a writer that people like, know, care about. And it's only 8 or 10 pages worth of comic book material. What is the problem, ladies? What exactly is the problem?
He diverged. He was the nail that stuck up. And the funny thing is, Scott Card's a Democrat. He's a lifelong Democrat. He's not a Republican.
Mm-hmm.
He's not a right-wing guy, and his only thing he diverged on was gay marriage.
Wow. And
boy, they lost their minds. And they make it sound, and it's funny because I remember one time he was going to be at a convention. I've been kicked out of a bunch of conventions too, and so I remember this when Scott Card got kicked out of a convention is because he was going to be a guest, and then somebody was talking about how, well, I'm gay and he makes me feel unsafe. His presence makes me as
that unsafe thing. Yeah.
Fuck. Yeah. As if a 60 something year old guy is going to leap off the stand into the audience and strangle a random person. You know,
yeah, what is that? What, like, why do people respond to that? Like, I hate that. It's so effective from these people who I get people, I get these weirdos who just kind of say, hey, listen, you know, Ethan Van Sciver is still out there circling the water. Stay safe, everyone. What the hell am I doing? Like, I'm not, what do you mean stay safe? You know, for goodness sakes, I say the same thing. Stay safe, own a firearm, you know, protect your home. That's actual safety. But what is, and people respond to it. They go, well, this person feels unsafe by your being here. So they get their way.
Yeah, it's crap. And the funny thing is I got kicked out of Origins as a gaming convention. I was the writer guest of honor, and they announced me. And within like 30 minutes, there was like this giant outrage mob had formed on the internet throwing this. I didn't even know about it. Right. And next thing I know, I'm hearing all this stuff about how I'm like the worst person ever. And this one lady was talking about how, and I'll get back to this because it's funny as heck, but she's talking about how I had been terribly rude and racist and flaunted my white privilege over her person of color husband.
Ooh.
I was like, I have no idea what she's talking about, right, at the time. And then so I got thrown out by the guy who organized the place, threw me out and didn't tell me. I found out from Facebook when he announced that I was being canceled as the guest of honor. And then I found out afterwards who this guy was that I had, how I had flaunted my white privilege over him. He's the son of a billionaire. And a couple years before, he had written an article about how this other convention, Gen Con, was racist. And he had zero evidence. He just decided that they were racist because he's a social justice warrior. So he just said, and in fact, I made fun of it. I fixed the article. I went through the article line by line. I made fun of it. But one of the lines that I was proud of was, he said, as I walked through this convention, I saw very few people who look like me. And my comment was, why are you physically fit? But so a couple years later, it turns out I was terribly rude and flaunted my white privilege over this guy. And by disagreeing with him, and because I wouldn't say that 60,000 random strangers were racist without evidence. And so I got thrown out of Origins for that, but it was kind of cool because it was the first time in my life I had more privilege than a billionaire. That was pretty baller.
Yeah, this whole thing about representation and all, you know, it's like an inclusion. I didn't know we were ever excluding anyone. The idea of saying that, you know, science fiction novels or comic books are for everyone, a strange indictment of industries that were always owned and controlled by the left. Yep. We were always the minorities in these hobbies, in these industries. We were tolerated here. So I didn't have the ability to exclude anyone from comics.
It's such a bizarre take that we exclude people, because here's the thing. I mean, like, I was the number, at one point I was the number one best-selling author in Baghdad during the war. Okay. And for people buying my books in the PX, and it tells you a lot about what my fan base is like. And so I go to book signings and my fan base is diverse. Like, it is genuinely, my fan base looks like America. Depending on where I'm doing a book signing in America, the audience looks like whatever the locals are, you know, across the board.
Yeah.
And I go to these conventions, these sci-fi conventions, where they have like what we like to jokingly call the mandatory diversity panel, right? That's the liberal political panels. And I walk in there and you know what that room is? Wow. It is 90% 60 to 70 year old white people. It's white liberals. And then the only young people are like white college liberal ladies, you know, like white moms. And that's it. And they're like, we speak for America. I go to a book signing in the Navy Yard and I've got like, you know, a bunch of Puerto Rican sailors I'm hanging out with. And they're lecturing me on like, you know, I'm keeping peep out of sci-fi because I don't cater to their whatever their bull crap is. I've got transsexual fans. I've got everything you could think of, just normal people who want to read books and be entertained and don't give a crap about the message beating them over the head. And there, the people who complain about us are like the least diverse people you've ever seen. And it's like a elderly KKK meeting when you look at these people.
Yeah.
But my gosh, they have weaponized that narrative about us being exclusive.
Yeah.
My publisher is a Jewish single mom. And right. I got her nominated for an award. And she's one of the most respected editors in all of publishing, in the history of publishing. She's amazing. And we got her nominated, and they blackballed her. Like, they wouldn't give her an award. Then a couple years later, they wanted to apologize to her, like the old school, like gentlemanly types. Like, we want to make it up to you. Mm. So they invited her back as a guest of honor. And you know what? They canceled her because these same people threw a fit and said, well, she's there, we feel unsafe.
Oh, boy.
You know, a Jewish single mom, you know. And, yeah. And what? Why does she make them unsafe? She exists and doesn't agree with them. It's unbelievable. They're the worst people in the world.
They really are, man. And I wonder if, I don't know. I feel like they found the right formula for manipulating everyone around them. And it's not, you know, people are, I always have to say, not liberals. These are not liberals. No. These are radical leftists. I miss liberals. I feel like I'm a liberal, you know.
They're eating the liberals now. That's who they're currently victimizing because they got rid of all of us. We're out of their reach now. And so they're getting people like Misty Lackey, you know?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah,
you made a mistake. You made it. You kind of fell out of line. Like, it's one big school of fish, and you zigged when we zagged, and therefore we must eat you now. Yep. And Mercedes Lackey would be like one of them. Like, why wouldn't they say, we understand you made a mistake. You're 72 years old. You called him colored when you meant person of color.
Yeah. And it's funny because every day or every week, there's a new one. Every couple days or somebody's getting canceled. Like, all the authors are getting canceled now because publishing is kind of cool because, you know, so many of us have gone indie or we're at publishers that are actually, you know, don't care. But I'm seeing every day, like, leftist authors or liberal author or leftist killing liberal authors, or books getting canceled. Like, the author will have a book, there'll be something, and there's a good liberal, like, it's a proper liberal author, and they'll have something in there that is like goes against whatever today's orthodoxy is. Mm-hmm. Someone will throw a tantrum. Next thing you know, the publisher pulls the book, and their career is over, you know, because they cross some line. It was funny too, because like all the of the many people shouting at me and calling me names all these years, I've kind of kept like a running tally, and I think I'm like 12 or 13 of those people now who have since been thrown out of the industry for like some sort of crazy sexual harassment thing, or creepy weirdo stalker behavior, or handsy touchy, you know, hashtag me too.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Craziness. All right. Let me read some more of this. You did thread here. You should have done it like an SJW would. You said, okay, everyone, listen up. Here comes the thread. And then
clap
launch it.
Every word.
Yeah, put a clap in between. all right. Mad props to Instapundit for using their powers for good. I don't think right wingers realize how little it takes to push an artistic product to prominence. If 1/10 of some of the big pundits, viewers, bought a book the same week it's going on the bestseller list. And that's true. I mean, We had Mike Barron, who was the writer of Punisher in the 1980s and early 90s. He's Comics Gate, and he did a book about the police. You know, he's like, during the riots of 2020, you know, when it was like cancel police, defund police, he did a book about how these police are heroes, and nobody would publish it. Everyone said, I'm sorry, we're not interested in your propaganda. This is Mike Barron. He's a prominent writer who's done great stuff. So we went
I know Mike. He's a good dude.
Yeah, he is a good dude. He doesn't stay up very late, though. He shows up on Comics Gate. Yes, he is. He shows up on Comics Gate Kings at 7 p.m. and he's like, I gotta go at 7:30. So but anyway, we love him. He went on Fox and Friends, and they promoted his comic book, and it did great. Suddenly, it got a whole lot of new backers and you know, readers. Boy, we need a little bit more of that. I'm just one person. I'm doing the best I can. My platform isn't as big as others, but we do need people who actually mean well in the culture war, mean to fight the culture war, to do a little bit more of that. You know, Instapundit, huh?
People don't realize how powerful they are as far as like this numbers game, as far as bestseller lists and whatnot. Like, if you wanted to put a book to the top of the Amazon charts, all you need to do is, if you can get about 1,000 people in one afternoon to buy a book, or, you know, 10,000 people to buy it over a week, congratulations, you just shot that thing right to the top of Amazon, which means 100,000 more people are going to see it. And so like some of this punditry, they have a great deal of power to promote artists, but you know, they just don't.
Yeah. I don't think it's really about that.
Well, some do, to be fair. I mean, I don't want to bag on everybody. It's not, they're not, it's not an equal.
I do. I want them all to. I really do. I think they have an obligation. And also, you know, I think people have an obligation to stop supporting these big corporations who have proven that they mean us harm. I love Star Wars, and not watching Obi-Wan Kenobi and The Mandalorian and Boba Fett is a great personal sacrifice to me. But I've stopped, and I'm never going to. I used to spend a lot of money on Star Wars toys. I'm not buying anything Star Wars or Disney ever again until that is that they apologize to Gina Carano. On top of that, they're going to have to make some serious changes at the top. How dare they go against the voters of Florida's will, the parents who voted for that anti-grooming bill? How dare they go against that? How dare that entertainment corporation become politically active that way?
That was the dumbest thing I think I've ever seen a corporation do. I was surprised how that shook out. Like, and then they doubled down, and it's like, man, Ron DeSantis does not give a crap.
I love him.
He's not a dude to play chicken with.
No. And, you know, I just look at that and I'm like, he's being righteous. What he is saying, I mean, yeah, it seems extreme what he's doing. He's actually going to yank the Mickey Mouse. Like, Mickey Mouse, by the way, should have been in the public domain 50 years ago. But Disney has exploited loopholes in the law, created political favors in order to extend the copyright on that character for an additional 50 years. It should be, Mickey Mouse should be in the public domain by now. And because of this, DeSantis, other Republicans in Congress are going to yank all of those laws and push Mickey Mouse into the public domain. That is devastating. That is absolutely devastating to Disney. But frankly, that's what you get. You know, that is what you get. You want to get involved in politics? Good. We're gonna take a closer look at you, remove your tax-exempt status and all of these privileges that you enjoy because you are Americana. Behave this way and see what happens. I love it. This is Republicans and conservatives actually standing up, and we need to do more of that.
It's nice to see some actual fight. And it's interesting because you see the left has no moral principles, like guiding principles whatsoever. And they try to use our principles against us. And they're all like, well, shouldn't you be pro-business? It's like, says the socialist who doesn't understand the first thing in the world about, you know, capitalism. And yet they throw that out there. It's like, well, no, because they're already not getting, they're already getting a special deal. It's already not a fair shake to everybody else anyway. They're getting a special perk. And if they want to go play political games, well, congratulations, you're now playing political games. And you went against the will of the voters of the state you reside in. Reap your whirlwind. I fresh out of pity for him. It's like, I have some Disney stock on my Robinhood app, and I just watched it go, whoo.
Yes, that's fun. All right, let's see. Books, comics, those actually don't take that many people buying them at one time to spike the ratings. Higher ratings get more new eyeballs. Games and movies are bigger. Same principles apply. I keep seeing idiots saying there are no conservative creatives. On the contrary, we exist. And many of us do rather well, despite having our industry politically stacked against us. And boy, is it. I mean, it really is overwhelming. And I know of many more political conservatives in the comic book industry who are terrified and are keeping quiet despite the fact that they know what's going on is wrong. It's just, I think they lack self-belief. And I mean, all I can do about that is just try to make this a safer situation for them so that they can move from the corporate teat into independence, which is a much better situation for everybody. I mean, you own everything that you're doing, don't you, Larry?
I own the rights, and then I sell them to Bann, and when I do movie stuff, I option it. But yeah, so I basically sell the rights and then they revert to me when they go back out of print. So, but no, I'm not indie. I started out indie, and but I am through a publishing house now. But my publishing house is an anomaly. It's one of the few that actually, there's no one else that would hire me. Basically, there's no one else who would buy books from me at this point. I basically have, my only options are independent or Bayon. That's it. I am toxic waste at any other publishing house.
Yeah, me too. That is definitely, well, I don't know for sure, but I'm pretty sure I'm blacklisted all over mainstream. I better be for what I've done. You know, I don't know what else I can do to get thoroughly, you know, blacklisted. Oh, man. But
yeah, if I'm not blackballed at all the big publishers, then I have like not living right.
Yeah, we didn't do something right. So, but I mean, this is the thing. So what can we do? Well, I mean, what you're saying here is that, you know, the punditry class, the conservative punditry class needs to get on the ball and start promoting conservative creators trying to build independent culture, because, you know, that's the only way this is going to grow. They are basically like sunlight and water for these seeds that we're trying to plant, and we need their help. And if they don't do it, if they just continue doing what they're doing, which is to go and pay for Disney, you know, Marvel, you know, whatever else out there, all of these companies that have made it clear that they really hate us and want to destroy our way of life, our belief system. They want to see that end. They believe that we are evil. You want to give them money. You want to give them money. You want to give them reviews. You know, I've said, like, Disney right now is a sick animal. They are a cancerous, sick animal. So going through their leavings, going through the shit that they leave behind and saying, well, this looks like a healthy poop and this one less so, their movies, it doesn't matter. The animal itself is sick. Who cares if Doctor Strange 2 was good or mediocre? It's irrelevant. You know, that animal needs to change. That animal needs to be put out to pasture or heal. Stop paying attention to that and start paying attention to, you know, conservative creators like myself and like Larry and like Shane Davis, but less so.
Well, one of the things I was going to say, the thing that I'm actually the most excited about right now in this topic is actually a weird one. Because the Daily Wire has started making movies, right? And that's cool.
Yes. Yes.
More important, they're making kids cartoons.
Yeah.
You know, so if they got Frank Fleming writing Chinchilla Time, you know. That, I think, is the single most important thing right there. Because we tend to get a little, you know, tunnel vision into our areas. But the fact that you see these guys doing children's program, huge. For Culture War, I think that's amazing. And it just needs to be good, not suck, and not be woke. And it's like gold. You know, so I was telling the writer of that the other day, I was like, hey, no pressure.
Yeah, I gotta get in touch with them a little bit. They were good enough to do a nice big interview video with me about the culture war within comics. And it did great. It got like 500,000 views.
That's amazing.
And did good stuff for Comicsgate. But boy, I'd like to talk to them and maybe we can get them looking at some of our Comicsgate properties and see what happens. But I mean, it just needs to grow. I mean, we really do need to kind of pull out. Why are we still there? Why are we still supporting these corporations?
I've got a weird prediction, and I might be totally off base on this, but I think what we're going to see is, I think we've hit peak woke. I think society's hit peak woke because regular people are waking up. Regular people are sick of this stuff. You know, Latinos don't want to be called Latinx. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Parents don't want, you know, drag queen story hour transition closets in school. So people are sick of this crap. And so the regular, normal, average person is sick of this. I think what we're going to see now is we're going to see a cultural swing. We're going to see repercussions to all these years of wokeness and just insufferable awfulness. And so I actually think, okay, if anybody's listening on this who's like a venture capitalist or happen to have $1 billion sitting around, invest in alternative entertainment properties now, books, games, comics, movies, because in I think we're going to see this shift back to the side. There's going to be massive millions of people hungry for products that aren't woke. Yes. I mean, look at Maverick, look at Top Gun. Holy crap.
It's doing so great. Yes.
It's making crazy bank and it's just not woke. It's not preachy. It doesn't have a right wing message. It's just not woke. It's just not preachy. It's not the message, you know. It's and so people poisoned. Are loving it.
Yes.
Reacher, the TV show Reacher was a big hit. And if you watch Reacher, it was good. But the thing is, it was just like a big tough guy punching bad people. Mm-hmm. There was no wokeness to it. And people loved it. So I think the market is there and is growing. And I think, honestly, if you had money to invest, then, man, start buying comics, get properties now.
Let's go. Yeah. And, you know, everything. Take a look at these books. What is the name of your publisher?
Bain, B-A-E-N.
Bain Books. Take a look at those books. They actually reached out to me. They were very nice to me. And I'll talk to them a little bit more. That'd be interesting to.
Yeah, probably Sean. Sean is our media, our media guy.
Yeah, maybe we could do some kind of illustrated something or other. We can kind of work together because, yeah, we just need to get stuff out there. Good entertainment as an alternative. If we don't, we have no business sitting around whining. If we're not trying to effectively make a difference, see, this is where kind of Gamergate failed. You know, Gamergate. What are they going to do? You know, if the gaming industry is completely taken over by woke, are they supposed to make like all their own video games that are going to compete with, you know, some of the big ones, some of the big franchises?
Yeah, because they spend hundreds of millions of dollars on these projects. It's like that's one of those, you know, good luck breaking into that.
Yeah.
And the funny thing is, I know a bunch of guys that work in the video game industry. I got a bunch of fans. And man, the stories they could tell, it sounds just like me in publishing and just like you in comics. Yeah. Same exact stuff going on there, you know, just terrible.
The left promotes the left. What a great thing to, I mean, it's just a simple few words here. The left promotes the left, no matter how shitty the product, they are all in. Why aren't we? Meanwhile, the right punditry is oblivious or willfully ignorant because it's easier to whine about the left than to actually compete. But we can compete. I know we can. Of course we can. There's a lot of really good stuff out there that isn't woke garbage. There's a lot of amazing art from brilliant people that's more focused on entertaining than shoving message down your throat. And this isn't me being personally selfish. Is it, Larry? Are you being personally selfish?
Oh, a little bit.
A little bit. Yeah, me too. I'm doing pretty fucking awesome comparatively. I built a big fan base and I sell a lot of books. But there are lots of great authors out there who get zilch attention in an industry that actively blackballs them for wrong think. I got to just remember, like, this just, as annoying as some comic skaters are to me, and some of them are, you should see some of these people.
Oh, I know. I believe you.
I fight with certain individuals. I got to remember this and soften my heart. You know, it's like, it's hard, like, you know, being in love with comics and then also being associated with an industry that hates you. And blackballs you for just believing basically what I believe. You know, I gotta be more patient. That's a special kind of broken heart. You know what I mean?
We still have to be good. You know, they still have to put good product out. I guess.
Oh, then forget it.
Yeah. No, the thing is, we can't back crap because if we back crap, then who's gonna listen to us anymore? You know?
Yeah, of course.
I mean, before I review it, before I promote somebody's book, I got to read it first to make sure it doesn't suck.
That's true, too. Well, I've got to be very discerning about what I promote, and I try to do that. You know, I promote crowdfunded comics that I haven't, like, fully read yet, but I look at them anyway, and I do my best to determine what I think is going to be good and promote those books, but I got to do more of that. It is my job. That's why I'm here. And this is what you're saying. I do what I can to promote other authors, but my reach is crap compared to the punditry. Yet I've been able to help guys get major career boosts just with my limited reach. Imagine what some of these mega influencer types could do. Instant bestsellers. I've been yelling about this culture war crap in publishing for over a decade now, so it's wonderful to see the right finally waking up to it. But they're still in their flailing around reacting phase. They don't realize how powerful they actually are. You don't have to just complain about the other guy sucking. Most people aren't going to boycott their sources of entertainment unless they've got alternative entertainment sources to turn to. If you provide alternatives for disgruntled consumers, they'll use them. Hashtag Comicsgate. The alternatives exist and are growing in number. The key is making people aware of them. God bless you, Larry Correa. You are, what a great thing to get to talk to you tonight. We are simpatico. We are on the same page. And I hope to be able to call you a friend. And I mean that.
Oh, man. Ethan, I was honored to come on. Thank you a lot. I mean, I really appreciate it, and mad props to what you're doing and the work you're putting in.
Appreciate that, everyone. I want to remind you, Larry Correa here, his new book, Servants of War, available now on Amazon.com. We've got over 1,000 people watching right now. Thank you so much, and more people will watch this later. People who are watching this as a rerun. Go check out in the description below this video, the link to take you over to Amazon to purchase this book, and go check out his other books too. Read this one if you like it. He's got plenty more where that came from. Larry, what an honor to have you here. I'm gonna say goodnight to you, and I'm gonna read these super chats. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Ethan. Appreciate it.
All right, we'll see you again soon. Bye bye. All right, well, that's total. That was awesome. What can I say? I hope I didn't talk too much. I feel like I'm a big mouth. I'm a loud mouth. I talk way too much about stuff when I should be listening. But what a cool guy. I'm going to read these super chats. Looks like we got a couple of super chats from a war campaign. Interesting. I don't know why they're back on the... why aren't you guys banned? Hope you're banned now. But let's see. Super chats. Oh, they gave me $20 to insult me. Okay. Jay Bomba fan says, say hi to Comicsgate Larry. He did that. Potato Radio says, two men who know Vox, Larry, Sad Puppies v. Rabid Puppies, EVS, etc. Al Comicsgate v. Comicsgate TM. I don't know what that means, but I think it's in my favor. I think you are, my friend. $5. Thank you for that. John F76 for $2 says, SFWA consists now of failed Harlequin book writers. I see a lot of like spooky cat ladies that are writing for them. Troy Neenan says, love Monster Hunter and the Insurance Agent audiobook series. Pete Callen says, I like this guy for $2. Steve Roberts says, just because you are romantically attracted to the chat doesn't make us gay, Uncle Lee. Doesn't it? DP Monahan says, I've been waiting since 2018 for a crossover of EVS and Larry, much in common. Also, Larry Correa talked to Dan Fraga, both rural California Portuguese farmers. So that's good. They have that in common. VT Sweetie for $5 says, just ordered two sets of the Cyberfrog action figures. Wow. Thank you. Appreciate that. Ron Guerra says, Larry, I enjoyed Son of the Black Sword. Benson Davido says, Larry, I love your Saga of the Forgotten Warrior series. Only modern fantasy that is gripping and thought-provoking. Not a cliche Mary Sue feminist character. Big ups from Southside Jamaica, Queens. Sarah Jacobs says, Stephen King named his son Joe Hill after a terrorist. Russell Hall for $2 says, an AK-47 doesn't do much against artillery. Son of Liberty Radio for $2. Mary Robinette Cowell, SF. W.A. Stotzi, Sean C.W. Korsgaard for $5. I have an anthology with a story by him in December. World's Long Lost from Bain Books. Jonathan Van Hurtum says, Larry, I just bought your new book. I can't wait to read it. You and Jason and Spock, Nick Cole, are my favorite authors. Monster Hunter International rocks. Please, P.S., please do not kill off Owen Pitt. Troy Neenan says, when is the next Tom Stranger audiobook coming out? Also, Tom Stranger comic book crowdfunder. The public needs it. Adam D says, great interview for $5. $5 from Bad Player says, we have to offer people alternatives while we're dunking on the woke skin suits, preferably in the same videos. Dunk and chill. I think I tried to do that here, you know. Century 331 says, hey, Larry and EVS, you guys rock. Thank you. That's $20. I appreciate that. As Eric July would say, the great Eric July, that ain't cheap. And thank you. I definitely appreciate all of you for being here. I told Larry, I said, I'm going to make this a short. I won't keep you because I assume he's got things to do. And I do, too. I'm working on some covers here for the Cyberfrog Second Chance campaign. Pretty excited about getting that going. Let me just see you guys here. guys are not saying anything good. Just saying dumb stuff. Wait, hold on. Let me say. Rick Riled Silver Lock says, you talk too much. You make yourself sad. You can't change fate. Don't feel so bad. No one lives forever. Good thing fate and destiny are different places free will defines. It's like poetry or something. Sean C.W. Korsgaard says, for anyone who wants to try Bane Books or Larry Correa, they have the Bane Book free library. Hundreds of our books for free. Oh, that's Sean. Sean's in the... Okay, that's you. I didn't realize that. Okay, cool. Thank you. Thank you for facilitating this meeting here. Potato Radio. Vox Day tried a radical version of puppies, like how he tried to trademark Comicsgate, I thought. Yeah, the rabid puppies was Vox Day. Okay, so they basically... All right, here's what I understand. Here's what I think happened. I could be wrong. Larry decided to bring conservatives in to vote for, his books, which is basically what John Malin used to do. Vox Day decided, since they stopped making that happen, to nominate weird dinosaur pornography for awards, which I think is hilarious. I think those were the rabid puppies. I think that's what it was. I read about it, but I wasn't there, so I can't really be sure. All right, I got to get back to work. Thank you so much, everyone. I hope you enjoyed this interview. Please back Cyberfrog Comics, back Comicsgate Comics. Go to comicsgate.org, where you can find all of the newest campaigns and info, news, updates about Comicsgaters. And then go to Amazon and purchase a copy of Servants of War. Do yourself a favor. It's a great time to just curl up outside, maybe read a comic or read a book, read an actual book in the sunshine. No, for real, I do. It is past Mastodon, and I promise you, I'm going straight to work right now. I've been drawing all day. Time to get back to it. Thanks, everyone. I'll see you again soon with another video. Be good to each other. Find a new Comicsgate stream to watch, and I'll see you again soon. Bye-bye.